Selectman Fidelli is stuck in traffic, so she said for us to go ahead without her. Of course, want to thank everyone for being here out in the snow and at an odd time. We wanted to be able to get our business done and get everyone home as quickly and as safely as possible. So, Mr. Reed.
Madam Chair, just to be clear, because of the state of emergency, this change in the starting time of the meeting was made with your concurrence today. So this is an emergency provision under the open meetings law, which the selectmen are able to make that determination when.
Thank you for that clarification. Before we begin with our regularly scheduled agenda, we do have with us this evening State Rep Ken Gordon, who would like to address us concerning the salt shed issue.
I would. Thank you very much. Thank you, Madam Chair and Selectman. Town Manager Reed. So for several meetings now before the selectmen, we've been discussing the issue of the MassDOT salt shed, which is currently on Crosby Drive, and MassDOT's plans to potentially move that salt shed to a different location. We've had a public information meeting, much discussion, and I have delivered a letter from MassDOT to Chairman Fleischman concerning some important updated information from Mass Department of Transportation. So I'd ask for you to read it if you're
sure.
interested
Thank
in doing
you.
So.
Yes, so I received this late this evening, and I will just read it to you. It's dated today, addressed to me. Dear Chairwoman Fleischman, I want to thank the members of the Board of Selectmen and the residents of Bedford for their engagement on the issue of relocating our maintenance depot at the interchange of Route 3 and Route 62. I also want to thank Representative Gordon for his leadership on this matter. Through his efforts to bring Bedford's elected officials and residents to the table with MassDOT, we were able to communicate our consideration of relocating the existing depot in Bedford, and we were able to listen to the concerns expressed by residents and elected officials about the impacts that move would create. After factoring in the feedback we received from the town, we have made a determination that we will revisit our options for relocating the Bedford Depot and will no longer be advancing plans to relocate the depot to the westerly lobe area of the interchange of Routes 3 and 62. Our recent meeting on January 15th followed a months-long process for us to undertake our due diligence in evaluating several alternatives based on select criteria for various sites. Over that past several months, I was in direct contact with Representative Gordon numerous times, who had provided assistance as we identified sites that could potentially site a relocated maintenance depot. For the duration of that time, the representative assured us that out of respect for our process, he would not take a public position on the issue until we were ready to present our plans to the Bedford community members for further vetting. For that, I especially appreciate his willingness to be a facilitator in our process focused on finding solutions. Decisions about where we locate key facilities required to carry out our core mission of keeping our highways safe are always made with careful, thoughtful, and deliberate consideration. And while our commitment to highway safety is unbending, we do our utmost to be good neighbors and to make decisions that factor in how those choices could have a quality of life, would have on the quality of life and the environment. Again, we want to thank Representative Gordon, the town of Bedford's elected leadership, and the residents who took time out of their daily lives to discuss with us their concerns about our plans for relocation. We appreciate the insight our discussions have yielded, which has been extremely valuable to us in informing our plans moving forward as we seek to evaluate other alternatives, excluding the westerly lobe area of the on-ramp for Route 3 South. Thank you again for your engagement on this issue. Sincerely, Thomas J. Tinlin, Chief of Operations and Maintenance.
So we have our answer. I have a little statement that I wrote too, just a couple of paragraphs. But and I'd start off, normally I start off by saying good evening, but now that you've heard the news from MassDOT, it certainly is a good evening, even if it's a snowy night. So I would turn back to some folks that come from the neighborhood. I don't mean to have my back to you or how else to do this. But congratulations to the residents of the Meadowbrook Road neighborhood and to the citizens of Bedford who were concerned about the impact of the proposed relocation of the salt shed. And thank you for your patience. I know it was tough for you to wait while I engaged in these sensitive negotiations, but it was also tough for me not to be able to break down and just tell you what I was doing every step of the way and almost every day of these last 2 months. Thank you to Chair Fleischman and to who came with me to many of these to much of the research that I had done. And Senator Barrett, thank you for your support as well. Thank you to the selectmen for your support. And thank you to MassDOT. They came to Bedford not to conduct a dog and a pony show, but obviously to listen to our concerns, and they did respond. And thank you to the drivers and the maintenance workers and the supervisors at MassDOT today for keeping us safe in these next 2 days. So what we did together was we created a path for MassDOT other than their plan to come to Route 3 and 62. And what you did was you put them on that path with your calls, with your letters, the petitions, the emails, and by showing up on that January night. So we did this together as a community between our organizers and your elected government. And that's really, that's the way it's supposed to work. So stay warm if you need help. I know the selectmen, myself, we're here to help you in these next 2 days. And congratulations. I'll take some questions outside because I know you want to get your work done within this meeting. I don't want to take any of the focus off of that. But this was an important resolution, and I want to share it with you.
Excellent. We clearly want to thank you for your hard work.
Thank you.
We're thanking everybody else. We thank you.
We've got a list of other things now.
I started with a list. Well, and I am at work on those other things as we speak. Absolutely.
Nice piece of work.
I have a press release that MassDOT sent through me that I'll post so that we can all share in that news.
And I'll forward the letter to Town Manager Reed so that he can have it on file. I know it will be in the physical mail shortly, I think.
Right. Yes, they put it in the mail, but they said because they were a little distracted with the weather going on today, they said it might not have hit today's mail. It'll probably hit, in fact, Thursday's mail. Okay?
Thanks very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
You
can
do it. Thank you.
What's that?
You missed the cruise.
I did miss the cruise.
Okay.
I think I saw this.
You heard about it.
I understand the name is Permit. It's really
next to the park.
I thought it was George was reopening the service, but I think it's
really be a good neighbor.
Okay. We're a slightly reduced number for our next item, which is the townwide communication study presentation. Not that that isn't as exciting. Mr. Alani.
Good evening. Thank you for having us. As a direction of the town manager, we put out an RFP for townwide communication studies. As a result, Intrada Communications, which happens to be a Bedford-based company, was selected. My right here is Talal, who's the president of the company. And I just want to take really quick second to thank our other departments, the police, the fire, the DPW, two ITs, the school department, IT, town IT, school IT, as well as the other senior staff for their input. This has been a collaborative effort by all the departments. We have about 29 slides, and I know we're pressed on time, so we'll try and skim through it really quickly. But feel free to interrupt us. Some of it is technical, some of it is non-technical, and feel free to interrupt us and we'll try and explain it. With that, I'll turn it over to Talal.
Good evening. So I'll go fast, and if I start talking too technical, just stop me so this way I don't get bored. So the study goal was to look at the town overall infrastructure for communication from connectivity to application and to future application and future implementation we need to do in the next 10 to 15 years. The audit was done to put the town of Bedford in the next what we call next generation communication, where everything interconnected, going paperless, having everything online instead of trying to do it paper and exchange paper, and everything like that. We looked at all the facilities, looking at the police and fire radio network. We looked at the data center. We looked at the school requirements. So we interviewed everybody kind of in town, every department. We did an interview at each department. We did data collection from the system they have in place. We took model numbers. We went through everything. And also, we talked to vendors who've been supplying the town of Bedford different elements of computing and communication to get the idea from them what the issues are and what we think we should head with our infrastructure.
So all that is documented in there.
So we have this, if anybody want to read something, it's all in here with more details than you're going to see. So we looked at the network, which mainly the data center where the town store all their application and data for all the town business. We looked at the connectivity between the buildings, how like the town hall connected to the fire department, to DPW. We looked at the phone system and the public safety radio network. This is the town, I don't know if, I'm sure all of you know, the town has a town-owned fiber network right now. It connects the town hall, high school, library, police, fire, and the middle school. And this has been built about 20 years ago, 15, 20 years ago. So that's what we looked at it first, and then we're going to build on top of that. We're not going to abandon the existing infrastructure. We're going to build on top of it. And this is a diagram will show you kind of the connectivity in town today. The red triangle up there, what's the point on this one? This one? Okay, so this is the red triangle here represent, that's the termination point on Great Road for the fiber. That's where the fiber stops there. And the yellow square here, it's an existing fiber between the high school and the middle school, but it's been giving the school a lot of trouble lately. It's about 30 years old. So we inspected, but we cannot say for sure need to replace or not until we start doing the work. But it's part of the budget. If we need to replace, we include it in the, it's included in the budget. So we're going to start with the phone system. As you see, it's there's several models, several phone system models implemented in the town right now from different vendors and different manufacturers. And you see the list per department, the phone system, and the data purchase and from as early as 1997. In the bottom, we put the cost. What's the vendor, do they charge the town of Bedford in case they have any repair or emergency call to come in on site and fix the issues?
On the mainstream communication, that's the wind system. Right now, whenever we need to buy a replacement, it's a reconditioned telephone. So they're not available anymore, and it's reconditioned.
Yeah, so in technology, I mean, it used to be a few years back, 10 years is a good time to depreciate equipment. Right now, technology is moving fast. I mean, you can still use it 10 years, but I mean, you're stretching it, and this was happening. The manufacturers say, we don't support it anymore, and you have to, on your own, buy used stuff. So, on the network, we went to the school and the town hall, and we saw a different brand name on the network, which is okay, but most of them, their end of life means they didn't even manufacture, don't support them anymore. Which means if there's an issue, it's going to cost more to replace them even more right now. You have to go somewhere like eBay or somewhere else to buy them. Fire department, we looked at the network, mean the infrastructure would make the fire department communicate between the headquarters and the trucks, and same thing for the police. And this is the list of the location where they have the radio and the repeaters around town for the fire and for the police. So we go back to the phone system, maintenance in general. So you have annual cost of the phone system being about $25,000, networking $7,500, fire department $5,900, and the police $20,000. And this data came from the town record. It's not something it just came from the town record. So they, you have the fiber in what we call the quad, the police, the fire area in here. And all the other departments, including the school, they depend on Verizon and Comcast to get their internet access to communicate between the school and the town hall in certain areas like Davis School and middle school. So it's not a one unified network for the town. It's depending on private network and public access. Means for the IT department has to add more equipment to secure the communication between different buildings. Sometimes the bandwidth is limited. And also, when it comes to the phone, for the school, they need to support PARC, which is another placement test to place the SATs, I believe, in a few years. And that's required more infrastructure in school and better bandwidth in general. And right now, the school, it's okay, but with implementation of the iPad in school and being online, is going to put strain on the network.
To replace the MCAS.
MCAS, I'm sorry.
That's okay.
Public safety, that's for police and fire. Today, we're using copper lines from Verizon, and Verizon's phasing out the copper lines. It's between 2 to 4 years, we can get straight answer, but it's going to be phased out. And if you follow the news, Verizon pushing for fiber everywhere these days, not just so, which makes the network obsolete in a couple of years if they decide to push for the fiber. And I know repair time for copper cables today, it takes longer to send someone to repair them versus a fiber cut. By law, they have 6 hours to repair it. Limited access, like we said, and like DPW is a good example. They go over Comcast today for internet access, and they have to go over Comcast back to the town hall to access their KVS and the SCADA system or any application residing here. And eventually, everything going online is going to be very tough, and it's going to be very slow for them to do that in the future. So, in summary, it's all technology, most of them not supported today. Equipment, it's end of life, so hard to replace it or find a spare part. And the maintenance cost goes up as the equipment gets older. So available solutions, so we're going to talk separate phone from the infrastructure, so you can have an inside mixing the two. On phone system, we have two options, either replacing the system as the breakdown, that means we keep the individual system. Every time the system breaks down, we replace it. That means we have to stick to copper line, stick to the service from Verizon without any changes. The second option is to build a town-wide solution, which one centralized phone system would support the whole town riding on the infrastructure we're going to build. It's less hardware, it gets you the same feature you have today, and it's less maintenance because you have one system, redundant, can support the whole town. The system will have a primary system and a backup. It's at DPW, so if the primary system goes down, the backup will kick in and you won't lose any dial tone or voice services. And we'll bring better service, will be digital service, you have more feature on it. There's over 250 features, but we won't go through them right now. So to give you an idea about the cost, if we do replacing as we go, and if you go back to the list, there's a few of them has to be replaced in the next at least a year or two. I mean, like anything from 1997 has to be replaced soon. And so if you go an average cost, depends. I mean, some department have 8 phones, some of them have 15. So we're talking $30,000 an average system is going to cost with the phone. So we're talking $270,000 roughly to replace all 9 systems. Now, with the existing system, we still have to pay Verizon for the lease line, which is the copper line coming to each building. Then there's an annual cost, and $25,000, that's to allow like 4-digit extension down between different departments. So we get charged for that separately from that copper line. And then you have a service cost, which is maintenance contract from different vendors or to deploy the system. So you're talking $270,000 in one-time cost for installation and about $135,000 a year in ongoing cost. You'll still have the same feature and still have operating the same way, but you have multiple systems to support throughout the network.
So, for example, we just had to replace the system at the public library. We held off on it. When I got here, we wanted to wait. It got to a point where it's a DOS-based system they have, where they were not recording, they were not receiving any messages, and their phones were really outdated. So we either had to run to Radio Shack, buy them an answering machine, or just it was funded a year ago or 2 years ago. So we decided to really, it was time for them, then we couldn't just call them off anymore for the study. But
having we chose the voice over IP system. Having that system is just really the system itself, the equipment, the phones, but they're not connected to any fiber optic. They still have, if you go back to that slide, they still have the Verizon, you know, the Centrex. They still have the leased lines. So it's still the infrastructure is still the same old one, except brand new equipment.
So with this slide, we're presenting the, if we go like a town-wide phone system, in all the study we did in here, we always went to two vendors to get pricing in there. So we can be comparing two vendors in here. The vendor A, the equipment costs about $375,000. Vendor B is $287,000. And then we talked to Verizon also, which is the current vendor to the town. And Verizon, they said they can offer similar service without buying all the hardware. And they come up with a $222,000 for part of the hardware, and the rest will pay it over recurring services, which you see in here, $155,000 a year. And so in case the town decided to stay with as an outsourced service, that's the option from Verizon available also. SIP trunking is the protocol we use to connect instead of the copper line between the telephone company and the new system. So that's fixed cost, recurring costs every year, $21,000 roughly. Optional, we have the monitoring service where the vendor will monitor the system for us 7x24 for any issues that alert us there's some problem with the phone, and then they can repair it for us remotely. And managed service, if we ask them to do the service themselves to repair it, are we gonna have one of the IT guys repair it? 911 services, it's regardless what we do, we have to do that today, and we do it partially today. It's a new requirement, mainly for the school and building. If someone dial 911 from their desk, the fire, the police, they wanna know which room in the building they dial 911. And that's something we have to keep, regardless what system we go to. So you have recurring annual cost of $73,000 in these two and $252,000 with the Verizon option. So we moved to the network. So the option we have is expand on the existing fiber network with all the buildings and the school and the facility. Move away from the fiber, build microwave network, which you have to put an antenna in each building to connect the building together. Or we can do combination of the two. And or outsource, go to someone like Verizon or AT&T, say, lease us the fiber to connect the building for us. So there's many options to do this. We'll all get us the same result from a technical perspective, but there's different costs and different con and pros for each one. So the two things we have to compare is the fiber and the microwave, and I'll go through this quickly because it's more technical than actually its cost. It's, with microwave, technically, you have to have an antenna, line of sight, and on the roof on each building. Cannot be hidden behind doors or anywhere, has to be line of sight. It's cheaper to deploy. It can be deployed anywhere. There's no issues like because it's line of sight, so we don't have to worry about digging any terrain or anything like that. If you need to move it, you just move the dish from one building to another, so it's easy to move. And it's the only thing is about it, if we have a high wind, we live in New England, it might be degraded at a certain time. Microwave equipment, it's limited by speed. Let's say we say we want equipment to handle 10 megabytes of speed. Do you buy the equipment? If you say we want to go to 10 times faster, then we have to replace the equipment. It's not the same equipment always support the speed. Where fiber, it's a cable underground or aerial. It depends what you put at each end of it will give you the speed you need. And right now, we're going for 1 gig for a minimum connectivity between the buildings. So, and fiber, it's buried, does not go bad as long as you maintain it regular. Fiber is more expensive. It's the way they bill for it is by foot. And it's about a $70 per foot when you do aerial, like mean on the poles. If you go underground, you want to pave the ground after that, the price goes up. So if you go on a hilly side or a rocky side, there's going to be more money to dig in there for the fiber. And if you decide to relocate, you can't take the fiber out. It's buried, stick there. So and also, the only thing, if we do aerial fiber, it could be influenced by storm, the fiber cut, someone has to repair it. But we go through the redundancy we built in the network. Next slide. So the infrastructure, the fiber, give us everything we need today. If we want to expand the network, make the town kind of ready for the next generation network, it gives us up to 10 gigabytes of speed. You have in-house experience between Sherwood and the IT department at school. They can maintain the network, so you don't have to hire additional people to maintain the network. Provide the capacity need for the park exams, test. It give you your own private network, one for the town, one for the school, connected together, but it's managed, owned by the town. And there's no single point of failure in the network. That's mean if we go fiber cut on Great Road, that's mean everything stops. We build a redundancy where it continue operating in different routes. And that's the cost. So to run fiber today, to expand it to the whole town, including the police and fire location for radios and repeaters, it's $495,000. It's one-time cost. And the equipment, $195,000. So we're looking at about $690,000 as running the fiber and equipment one-time cost. If we do the microwave, it's less, total $331,000. And if we do outsourcing, but that's mean we get fiber from different, for the rest of the buildings from different, like Verizon, AT&T, will be $15,000 initial cost. And we talk about the current cost there, but you still have to buy equipment for the network. And if you go outsource with Verizon, it's going to charge $196,000, but that's not including, that's including the police and fire equipment also, radio and repeaters. So we're talking $521,000 if you go outsource. So in this three rows here, we're talking the 10-year cost, because that's the town operate based on 10-year cycles. So to operate the network over 10 years for fiber is $300,000, for outsourcing $1.3 million, and if you go outsourcing with these two, like with public safety or not, almost the same price and operating cost.
So these are monthly recurring costs.
I'm sorry, over 10 years.
Over 10 years.
No, total 300.
Correct.
Yeah. Okay, just make sure it's not monthly, $300,000.
No.
Okay.
It summed up all of the costs,
yeah.
Recurring costs over 10 years.
And this item here is equipment support. That's mean when we buy these equipment here, the manufacturer asks to buy a maintenance contract on the equipment. It's usually 15% of your cost, what you pay for the equipment. So this item here, and I need to point here, all these prices here are budgetary number. I mean, usually it's retail plus minus 20%, because there's no bid out for pricing. We can't ask for accurate pricing because there's no bid out. So this is that kind of budgetary number. In my belief, from my experience, they'll always go down. They will never go up because they're already on the high end. But so if you look at the whole thing, these two items, this is the cost of operating the network, $593,000 for the town-owned fiber, with microwave, $692,000, 1.7 for the last, 1.8 for the last two. And there's a lot of details in here. I mean, I know we crunch on time. We can go over all the stuff, but I think I'm stuck with this one. Maybe I have to come back. So this is the network will look like after we build it. The solid, the blue one, the existing one today in town. So these are connected, what we call, it's single point of failure. That's mean if there's a fiber cut here, you lose the police station and the fire station at the same time. They can't talk to each other anymore. What we did is the red one is the new network we're proposing, where we connect all the buildings, and each building will have two entry to the network. That means if one side goes down, then we have another way. And if you look at DPW, Crosby Drive, and Pine Hill, we put in microwave links up there. And the reason for that is a cost effective to do, because going fiber all the way around the area is going to cost a lot of money because the terrain is very difficult. And so we decided this solution is better, cost effective, and will give us the same thing we need if we put a fiber in place. And that will take care of the public safety network. We'll give the school the connectivity. And if you look at here, the school can have their own network also, so they can physically separate it, but at the same time connect to the town hall network for as required. And you look at it today, instead of each building have their own, or each two building have their own internet access from Verizon or Comcast, we're bringing two major carrier, Verizon or AT&T at each end. If Verizon, let's say, have a problem, they can't deliver, the internet is down, we can roll back to AT&T and reverse versa. The same thing for the voice, the same network. We deliver, they deliver the digital voice for us over AT&T. If it goes down, they can roll it over Verizon. So that gives you full redundancy at all time. And this is like industry standard, it's not like black box, no one can repair it in the future. It's industry standard based on the knowledge you have in town. And we talked to the manufacturer and we get their opinion on the design also. So it wasn't done in a closed room on our own. Any question on the network? The next thing we looked at it is the SCADA system, which is a technology used to monitor water and sewer pumping station around town.
I'm sorry.
Go ahead, Caroline.
I'm sorry. Just before we go on, I didn't realize we were moving on to a whole new subject. Okay. I do have a question, and I think I just need a little bit more detail. Okay. Can you talk more about outsourcing? And I guess the basis for my question is, what's to prevent us from being antiquated in 10 years after the 10-year support, the way the technology moves? So. You talked
so
about three different choices.
The outsourcing, technically, the vendors in this case is Verizon because they are the vendor in town, and we talked to them. Technically, you don't buy the whole infrastructure.
Mm-hmm.
They build us a huge network, and they say we'll lease your partition on our network to operate your voice system. So they'll hire the staff to maintain it. They'll be responsible for it all the time. What you need to buy is your phone, and everything else they do on their end. You still have to do the 911 services. Still have to buy, convert the number from analog to digital, but they'll be terminated their network.
So could you go back to the slide that shows those costs? There was a comparison.
So Caroline, you're asking specifically about obsolescence and protection against
correct.
That?
Correct.
Okay.
Which slide you're referring to?
There.
This one. Okay. So this is...
That's just for the phone system. That's
correct. Not correct.
So what let's say in this case Verizon is going to say, we'll give you the service. You
mm-hmm.
don't have to buy the brain of the phone system.
Mm-hmm.
We're going to lease you part of that, and that's part of the lease you're going to do in here with them. And they
okay.
charge you per phone or per number too. So that's why they bill you. So if you say, I have in this building, I have 20 phones, Verizon is going to say, I'm going to charge you between $19.99 or $24.99 per phone. And that's what you pay in Verizon.
Okay, maybe this is the wrong slide. So I'm looking for...
Comparison fiber market.
Yes. Maybe there was a different chart further ahead.
Forward. This one here?
No. Nope.
Next one. That one.
There, okay. That one. So my question is twofold. How do we prevent ourselves from the equipment that we're purchasing and spending this amount of money on from being obsolete in 10 years? At the end of, if we're looking at the equipment support for 10 years. So what's to prevent us?
In technology, you can't prevent yourself if you don't upgrade your equipment every period.
Okay, so this is a forecast of us doing this conceivably every 10 years.
If the technology, yes.
Yeah.
Okay.
It is, technology evolving. I mean, it used to be 10 years a good time, and that's what the tax code, 10 years depreciation and everything, because that's the life cycle. Right now, most enterprises go 5 years
mm-hmm.
because technology evolving so fast.
Yeah. And by not purchasing it ourselves and by going through the outsourcing,
yeah, but
are we more protected? Are we more future-proof, I guess?
No, the burden on Verizon to upgrade the equipment to give you the same feature all the time, but you're paying for it on the recurring cost, which is high on a monthly basis.
Okay.
So Verizon's saying, I'm going to give you this, but I'm going to cover my costs
In the 1-3
yeah.
number down the bottom, right.
Yes.
Yeah.
The 1-3 number, okay.
But there's an aspect of this that's the hardware, and then there's the aspect of it that's the network. And in terms of the actual fiber network that you would lay, and a combination of fiber and microwave, that material will last more than 10 years. The
fiber will last more than 10 years.
Correct. Mm-hmm.
I mean, you're not going to have to replace a fiber every 5 years, 5 or 10 years. The fiber technology is the equipment at each end will maybe have to replace every 10 years. I mean, you look at it from your home today. I mean, you have a DSL 10 years ago, then they have the cable modem, now we have Fios. And every time you upgrade, you want faster speed, you replace the box in the basement.
Right, you don't rewire the house.
You don't rewire the house. So you're replacing some equipment.
Well, this is rewiring the town.
Well, because right. The town doesn't have the rewiring already today.
Okay, I understand. I can understand. Okay, thank you.
So we go back to this SCADA system. So the town has four water monitoring stations, 31 sewer pump stations. Today they use a dial-up system modem at each location to communicate to each pump station, or in case of an error, the pump station dial to the DPW, to certain but different locations. And also there's third-party monitoring the service today. The software, I'll use the term, it's on the last leg technically. It's at least 10 years old and is not going to be upgraded anymore. It has to be replaced, and that's the plan if they want to do anything with that system. Convert all analog modem to 3G, 4G modems, because the modem are dying, has to be replaced, and it's hard to find them these days too. And with the upgrade, we don't need a third party to monitor the system for us. So this is the cost of doing the SCADA system. So you have a software cost, about $31,000 to buy the, what we call, it's the same, it's a 3G, 4G modem, which is the same data we use today, the block you buy from Verizon to connect to the internet wirelessly. So they have those, and it's about $41,000. And to do all the locations, about $280,000 roughly. To do just the upgrade of the structure. So today, the way they've done today, we have phone lines. Verizon has 7 lines, $45 a month they're charging us for the phone lines. So annual cost of $3,700. The sewer phone lines, there are 30 of them, $16,000. And then we have a third party monitoring all these lines in case any alert on the sewer or the water, they call the DPW saying you have an issue, and that will cost, it's costing us about $9,000 annually. So we have total cost of $28,000. With the upgrade, we go with the 4G network, and we have total cost of $11,100 a month, and we don't have to use a third party for monitoring because that will go directly to the system and will dial out or send a text message to the person on call. So we have an annual saving of about $17,000 in here. The one issue in here, even if we go with a 3G or we just buy a better version of the analog modem, the software has to be upgraded at the DPW. I mean, there's a cost we have to do. And technically, you're buying the software, but you're not benefiting from the whole feature of the software.
So basically, the $31,620 you have to do very soon, regardless whether you upgrade to the 3G, 4G, or you stay with Verizon, phone.
And that might trigger also, if you upgrade the software, it might trigger the modem in the field might not communicate correctly with the software because they're at least 15 years old. Even the manufacturer, when I call them, they just went to their book to find the model number for us. So it's not something you can buy anymore. So.
Is there redundancy or backup built into the system?
No. So this redundancy is based on Verizon towers around town. So it's saying if you have Verizon service, you'll be on the same service around town. The good thing about it, it's some area where the fiber is going to pass around town, like Shawshin Road or across the street from the DPW, we're not going to put the 4G modem. We're going to connect it directly to the fiber, and that will build it. And those are the two main stations in town, I think.
Mm-hmm.
The Pine Hill, it's going to be on fiber, and Crosby also on fiber.
So that builds redundancy at those two points?
Yes. The only one that's not going to build redundancy is on the sewer pumping station, which they depend on Verizon network.
Okay.
And those, if one tower goes down, I think Verizon have a bigger issue. They're going to rush to build it because you won't be the only one on these networks. Um, public safety, so it's go back to the same issues. 10-year cycle, the equipment needs to be upgraded. I know that the police on fire went through a couple upgrades in the last 2 years, but also they're still connected to our copper network. So eventually when Verizon say, I can't support your copper anymore, they have to buy additional hardware to sit between the existing equipment they bought in the last 2 years and to communicate to the equipment in the field, which technically the radios and the repeaters in the field. So we have the police dispatch center. It's around $248,000, upgrading the fire channel 1 and 2, and then fire analog, same thing, and digital upgrade. So we have talking $591 total cost. That's if we decided to go from copper to fiber or even microwave. So either way, as soon as Verizon say no more copper, this is going to trigger some changes in that. And this price is based on today. And 2 years from now, I cannot tell you what this is going to be. And this is installation cost. And this is our first year cost for the public safety network. And in here is the maintenance contract on the equipment proposed by the manufacturer, which is technically about 15% or less because of the basis state contract. And the vendor cost is when we call the vendor for any issues, we need to do outside the maintenance contract. And these are projected costs in these columns here.
So when it says total first year, you're summing across the first two columns,
correct,
the capital and the installation.
Correct.
And then you'd have to also add on the first annual maintenance cost of about $73,000, $74,000 and
correct,
the vendor's cost. So essentially you're doing the 727 plus the next two columns would
correct,
actually be your actual first year cost.
Correct.
Okay. So that's another 100,000. So it's about 827 instead,
yeah,
of 727.
But we left those here because...
Sure, no, to break them out, I understand.
Break them out, yeah. And also it depends on your negotiation. You may get them
right,
master light, you may say...
Yes.
There's a different way to do this. So, and we mentioned that, the different way to save it in the
right,
in the study, how you save on a maintenance contract too.
Okay.
Quick question, dude. Can we buy some sort of dispatch equipment this year?
So, what?
Chief Grins, you want
to? Okay. So, there's a couple things about this slide. I'm not sure that the slide that's up there matches what you have in front of you.
Yeah.
Is that accurate?
We're missing a row in our handout.
So, the row in your handout. So your handout's accurate. Is the fire equipment is already digital capable? Is that fire channel 1 and 2? Is the $65,000 currently? There are switches over to the copper, so we can transmit over the copper. That $65,000 is the switch necessary, so we can transmit over fiber. The equipment itself that we bought, both dispatch and fire, and there's actually a capital request for fire this year, is already digital capable. What this project will require is the purchase of switches to get into the fire network. So it's not the equipment itself. The equipment itself is all IP-based and capable of functioning over fiber. We just need the purchase of switches.
So our existing equipment is compatible,
correct,
with this.
Yeah.
If the move away from copper to fiber.
Correct, and it's actually been tried. There's one connection that runs from the police to the fire station, over one radio system. We have existing fiber connections, so we tried these switches on that connection when we did the new equipment, and it works actually much better than the copper. So we've had a very positive experience of running that one connection over fiber. So the cost that you see is just associated with upgrading switches from the analog to.
So the version that we have in our packet doesn't have the line that says fire analog to digital upgrade. So that $100,000 that's up in the slide is what you're saying we wouldn't need to expend?
Correct.
Okay.
The equipment is already digital capable. It's still, when you upgrade the switch, you will be upgrading to a digital switch. The equipment itself that we purchased over the past 10 years, we seen this on the horizon, and everything that we purchase is IP-based and capable of switching to the fire.
Thank you for that.
So I apologize. We made the correction, and I thought we made it on the slide, too. We printed it. Apparently, we didn't save it. So that 100,000 across, that's deleted. Mm-hmm. And that's why we call it additional interface equipment. The switch is really like Dave said.
Okay. Thank you.
The other option, I mean, we've thrown this in the area, and when we build the infrastructure in town, there's a way to combine the infrastructure between the police and fire. Instead of having multiple antenna, they can share the location, share the equipment also moving down the road. But until we build the infrastructure, having in place how it's going to be built, we can't just give a cost right now. Awesome. So this is a slide regarding if the town decided, I mean, there's a town has a location where it's big interest from the cell carrier to have an antenna built or tower built to provide cell service around the area. And we identified two locations is the Pine Hill and Carlisle Road, because they're already on a, Pine Hill, it's where the water tank right now, and Carlisle Road is where the season storage is. And both location is very appealing to carriers to put an antenna there to serve the town or surrounding area too. So we did a study if what would be the cost to build these antenna, and then we have the town on this. I mean, the town will build the infrastructure and lease it monthly to the carriers. And that would be the cost in here. So the annual revenue per $36,000 per customer. If we usually on a tower, you put three to four carriers, so you have $36,000 annual revenue per customer. So you have about $146 a year and a $12,000 maintenance on that. And then you have $134 net revenue annually. And that will cost to build is about $170,000 per location.
We have current revenue coming in from Crosby Drive, Pine Hill Road also?
Yes, we do.
So this would, this is envisioned as additional source of revenue?
This would be the currently, this is as constituted right now. One thing to look at on this also is the tower height's only 100 feet. Based on that construction cost, we would have to be above that level. The water tank itself right now is 100 feet.
But you're correct, that would be an additional
for
revenue.
These are two new additions.
Yes, two new ones.
Yes.
The ones with water, I'm sorry, yes.
It was requested, this has nothing to do with the townwide study. It was requested that we do this in additional, for additional source of revenues.
Just Crosby Drive right now.
Yes, right now it's just Crosby Drive.
So is the second box just if we only had two carriers instead of four?
Okay. Yeah. And most of the time is when these towers are built, you don't build them unless you have at least two carriers interested in them. You sign a lease with them before you proceed.
And how long do those leases generally last? Are they long-term leases or are they annually? You know, I mean, what I'm
most
saying.
Most towns do 20-year.
Yeah.
Most towns do a 20-year lease.
20-year.
Yeah.
Okay.
And this model here, we say, if the town doesn't want to upfront the cost of building the towers, if you do profit sharing with the carrier where you give them the land and they build the tower, they put the equipment and they manage it, and you do profit sharing between you and the carrier. And if you say profit sharing 25%, that'll be your annual revenue from the towers. So there's no upfront cost for the town except providing the land and access to the land. And you already have access to that. And you can negotiate profit sharing with the carrier 25% up to 40%. Usually they want to maintain more than 50%. And that will give you the annual revenue if you have four carriers or two carriers. So it's lower risk, which means less money for upfront for the town. So this slide kind of summarizes everything we talked about, the total project cost in if you today decided to move forward and you want to do the whole thing together, that would be your, technically, the first year cost, $2.2 million. That's including the infrastructure, phones, public safety, everything we talked about. There's nothing prevents you from breaking the project in a different milestone, do one this year, the second part next year, so you don't have to do it all together. But you're looking at $2.2 million today if you want to proceed with the project. And that's including the phone, infrastructure, the SCADA system, the fire and police department, everything all together.
Go back to that one. Just a clarification, though. Just not to mislead you. Yes, the 2.199, this is the total cost if we were to go ahead and do the whole project. But part of this...
At some point, you have to do it individually if we don't, say, take the whole project. For example, the phone system that we have to replace individually. So this is not a reflection of the total project. Because part of it you have to do at some point soon. But if you were to do all of it together, run the fiber and do the network and do the schools and the town buildings, rewire a few things, then this is the cost of the whole project.
On our list tonight, and the item that came before capital expenditures is a $378,000 for townwide phone system. Is that the
included?
75,
yes.
Up there?
Yes, correct.
Do you have that, man?
And so, in effect, we are starting down a road of replacing some things.
It's easier to read.
Correct. Like we use the library as an example. We couldn't wait any longer, so we have
this
to do a new phone.
This 378 is all the rest of the town.
The townwide phone system, yes.
The issue here, I mean, if you go with the project or not, eventually down the road, you're going to start replacing things as they break down. And you're going to start putting stuff piece by piece together. And it's going to be harder when you don't have the whole picture. I mean, you can take this way we're going to adopt for the next 5 years, and this way we're going to implement it. You can do that. But if you say we'll do nothing, then you have issues. You're going to have to replace the phone system. You're going to replace some network equipment, the internet access. You have to replace them either or down the road. And this is based on what Vic kind of run analysis for borrowing costs, what we cost to build the network. If we go do the phone system first, so that'll be the total borrowing cost. And if we do the fiber network infrastructure, we have $2.4 million borrowing cost.
I'd like to also note that it's being proposed that the phone system is not going forward for a bond, that it is going to be paid through the tax on the aggregate. So, in fact,
it's
showing the
bottom cost. So then the bottom part is everything other than the phones?
Yeah, this is just to do the infrastructure, but that has nothing to do with the phone. This is the phone by itself.
Great.
Done.
Thank you very much.
Sorry for going so fast.
That's fine, and I appreciate, your trying to get us as much information as we can. It's a lot to digest. Are there any questions at this time that any of the selectmen have?
What do we envision as a timetable for these improvements?
I mean, it depends which way you're talking about. I mean, but the fiber is going to take at least 3 to 6 months to get implemented. I mean, actual work from the day you say, this is a purchase order, go ahead and do it. Phone system, it's going to take about 3 to 6 months also. And you have to figure out also, the school system only can work, do implementation in the summer, so because of the students. So you're giving yourself a year to do everything and trying to make it work.
When you calculated the numbers for the fiber, you said you got some two different vendors to look at what it might look like. Was that just linear feet, or did it take into account any of the other, I know you said that there are terrain issues and other things having to do with that, particular to Bedford?
So what we did for the price for the fiber, actually we had a company come in and did the survey. They drove around, went to each building, We looked where the fiber coming to each building, if the manhole we can use, any conduit underground we can use. So they did the survey of the town, figured out where, how the fiber's gonna run. And one thing we mentioned is fiber's gonna be underground because it's already, there's a space for it underground, and some place where to go aerial is cheaper to do it this way, starting to dig. Like if you go down Concord Road to Davis School, it makes sense to go aerial than to try to go underground.
Okay, so those were taken into account with that number?
Yes,
okay.
Absolutely.
Specific to that, great.
So, sir, what parts, if any, of this are on the 6-year capital plan?
All of it. So
which,
for
26, which way are you assuming we go?
So we, I believe we proposed for FY 2016 the phone system, and then for the following 3 years we broke the project into a 3-year phase. What, first of all, once we do the phone system,
well, are we talking about all three things, the pump stations, the towers?
Yes.
Yes. Okay.
But following the phone system, if we were to do the phone system first, then you have to follow immediately with the fiber optic. You have to have the infrastructure in place so we can really capture all the savings and connections and the, you know, efficiency of the system. So the fiber optic will follow immediately, mm-hmm, the network. And then we move into the buildings and start doing the switches.
So you, to answer Mike's question then, you imagine this being spread over about 6 years?
For budget-wise, we did it this way. If you were to say you have 12 months to do it, then we'll do it in 12 months.
Anything else?
But, yeah.
Just to also be clear that there is an immediate savings once we start implementing this from what we're paying today from Verizon. So at some point, it might be good for us to show what the budget appropriation from an operational standpoint would be as soon as this is implemented compared to what we're paying today for services.
Sure.
Because there will be some savings, which essentially can be put towards paying for the cost of implementing the system.
Okay, so we need to crunch some numbers now that we have all of this information. Is there anything else to ask at this point from anybody? Thank you both.
Thank
very
you.
Much.
Thank you.
Okay, our next item is the proposed fiscal 16 through 21 capital projects plan, capital expenditure committee recommendations.
I know that our town is going to do a great job. We don't have any issues on the roads. But just in case,
this is to get us home.
This is for home use. All right? It's a chargeable light, okay? It doesn't need batteries, right?
I love your optimism.
And you remember, the Boy Scouts.
Be prepared.
This isn't worth more than $50.
No. Yours wasn't. Mine. Yours wasn't. Oh, don't worry, Victor, I'll get you one. I'm with the card and split. I'm wondering why you asked me here this evening.
Well, we have before us a memorandum that has attached to it a list, capital projects, and we'll review that.
If I may, I think the best way to address this is to give the process, that is to give just a little bit of a look back on how it used to be and the noticeable changes going forward to show the improvements on the new system and the new process. We still have 9 members of the Capital Expenditures Committee made up of 3 liaisons, selectmen, schools, and FinCom. And we also have the 6 members at large. Now, just like the diversity that we have here tonight, if we were all of the same ilk, the same thing, it would be a very different process, but with the 6 members at large and the 3 very dedicated people from the liaisons, this process, I want to show you that this year, more than ever before, and this is my 12th year, I believe, the Capital Expenditures Committee has really owned this process. It's a hybrid this year. Going forward, it's going to be really looking at 6 years out. But in the past, you know, 45, on average, 45 requests would be given to us for $4.5 million, and there was anywhere between 1.2 and 1.5 million in allocated funds for it. So there was always a shortfall. There were also a lot of things were done, like on the other side of the ledger, all sewer, all water, and Mark used to always make sure that we made a distinction, and it wasn't sewer, water, but in fact separated. Mark, can I have some more, please? Mark was our liaison for a long time. The department liaisons in the past have gone out there, and this year, even more so with the department heads. The distinction this year is the department heads themselves sat since last May with themselves, going over all of the various requests that they had. It's kind of an easy way to say there was no catfights this year. The clause didn't come out. They said, listen, I need this really right now. Maybe I can move this down the road a little bit. And they worked together in their committee, collective committees, and came up with, the term uses almost like self-vetting of all the requests. In that process, we, CEC, then received the presentations for this year, and the future we'll be receiving for not only the current fiscal year, but years going out. Taking a look at a six-year plan provides a lot more, a lot stronger look at the future. There's fewer surprises. Once the new system had the software with all the items, how many 8-inch, you know, black elbows we had for water pipes, how many switches we had on computers. It's all in there now, and it's really, not that they didn't know it before, but now it's all out there. And it's listed in this massive computer program. It gives a far better look at what's needed. The department heads should be commended for all the hard work. This year, I said it earlier, I want to just say it again. Capital Expenditures took a stronger ownership position of it in how it's going to be in the past. Currently, we still are, you know, an advisory committee to you all and to FinCom. And in the past, I remember sometimes, you know, even in the selectmen's meeting, I remember department heads standing over here and saying, geez, I'll trade you this for that and another one over there. And Mark would be the only one probably remember Gordon. I remember him going down the list, like 17 down, and saying, no, I want this one up here. It was like the wild, wild west. Now it's all, there's more collective thought in how it's going together. And as they present to us, and we in turn to present to you in this right here. Instead of having a number from 1 to 45 and assigning it in the past, one being the best, one we need to, you know, look at the most, we changed that a little bit and had different, we call them buckets. There was a 0, a 1, a 2, and a 3, and actually a fourth number. The zeros, and you have it on your, if everybody's read it, I don't have to reread it, but it gives you the what that matrix is about. Mm-hmm. Zero being a much better, it's like a golf number. Lower score is much better. This year we also had threes where if the committee felt that this is something that's not ready, not right, as it says on that, you know, it goes off another year or so. And then there was also the X's or the fours. We said, yeah, this isn't the way to go. And that's reflected there. You'll also see at the bottom of that list in some of them, let's say there were one or two requests that came up, and it was either an A, B, or C for the department, and we chose the B. Well, then the A and the C would be withdrawn because B was chosen. A good example of that would be we just talked about it with the voicemail telephone systems. Because of what you just saw in the last presentation, these will be postponed until some future time because it may not be needed. All right. Also in your Dropbox, you should have received a set of standardized questions that we ask each and every department head when they're making the presentation. And in the process, after they've had given their presentation, what would happen is they would come back, we would come back and say, okay, we have clarification on this? And each and every time they came back with very detailed emails so as not to have to come back and present. This is really a whole new paradigm. You may have heard me in the fiscal planning meetings. I was having challenges early on trying to put my arms around it. And I know that right now I'm far more in favor of this the way it's worked out. Don't know how it's going to work when there are fewer dollars to go around, but you know, when there are enough pennies to match the list, then by all means we should be doing that. The investment in the infrastructure of the town, very, very important. What's going to happen now is, so we gave the presentation to FinCom. It went well. And hopefully I'll be able to answer any questions that you have here tonight. And it's back to your court, if you will. As the committee's an advisory committee, let's see how much you put into, how much validity you put back with saying how we did. And I think that going forward, that will be a much stronger an ownership of it all the way across the board. So with that, please.
Well, let's see, would you explain the last column, the average, what happened?
Okay. So we do have the 9 members, and each one was asked to vote on these, or rank them, if you will, on a 0, 1, 2, 3, or 4 basis. The average there would be all the 9 members pulled together, the aggregate, and then divided to give you a 0. You'll also see, and this is a suggestion of Bill, which is excellent. If you look in the top tier there on the first page, it starts with DPW sewer pump station, and on the left-hand column, it's 8 and then 12. These are the numbers as the departments had them. The average score on the right-hand side, 0s, 1, 2, 3. The first 3 items were all 0s. That means each of the 9 members had to have given it a 0. And then it moves up to 0.11. It's at the top section there. There's 15 of them in that. That's about the top 20%. Then the next section, which goes down to here, there's 22 items there. And then it breaks down. The last one is 12 items, and then finally 7 before you start to get into the those other ones.
So what's the significance of these section breaks?
Why don't I answer that? The problem was, as opposed to previous years where we numbered things 1, 2, 3, 4, et cetera, down, the averages came out in such a way that there's a very smooth curve of as the numbers sort of blend on down the page. And so what I suggested was if we took the total number of different scores, average scores, and divided that into fifths, quintiles, that there would be 5 different numbers in each score. Instead of drawing the line after X number of projects, because what would be the difference between a project that scored 0.11 that was falling above the line and 0.11 that was below the line? So you'll see that the first group there, you have 0.11, 0.22, 0.33, and 0.43. So there's 5 different numbers in the top section. There's 5 different numbers in the next section, 5 numbers in the third section. It's interesting though that the dollar amounts come out pretty evenly between each of these sections too. It also does not worry about how they were financed. It's strictly a ranking, regardless of financing, all the way down. And to give you some idea of the relative importance of these. So the top section is clearly the most important fifth of the scores. The next group is the next level. So that's the top 40%, the first two groups of scores, and it drops off after that. And how far down this list we as selectmen want to go ultimately will depend on how we feel about the financing and about Victor's previous presentations to us about our willingness to borrow money. The original version of this, I might add, showed, for instance, the telephone system we were talking about tonight, which is in the second group, and it's marked as number 33 on the far left-hand column, about a third from the bottom, of $378,000. That originally, there was assumptions that that should be bonded. The Finance Committee felt at their last meeting that that really ought to be taken out of available cash, available. And because of what the auditor said to us the previous meeting we had here, where he complimented on the fact that we reduced the amount of bonding that we were doing, and he thought that was a very good thing that the town was doing, reducing the amount that it was borrowing. And the Finance Committee picked up on that and said, let's follow that lead and move that out of bonding and into cash. So that's what's going on.
What's the number in the model?
The number in the model is the number that we show there at the bottom, 2,839,664. That number is a placeholder in the model for the full amount of the based on, or it will be based on what you determine to be the projects that you want to put forward. As for the auditor, I just kind of want to clarify. I did talk to him about that. I think he was just making note of the fact that the bonding had decreased. I don't think he was making a statement that is, in fact, you know, a positive thing in the sense that, you know, the market looks for the S&P looks like, so he was just making an observation that, in fact, our percentage could probably just decrease by 1%, which is, you know, he looked at it as a good thing, but I don't think he looked at it as having to come to invest in it.
But the Finance Committee took it as a comment that should be followed, and rightly or wrongly.
If I may reiterate what Bill said with respect to each and every one of the requests was reviewed on its own merits without any type of funding source brought to it.
So in the spreadsheet that we see, each subgroup has its sort of a subtotal in italics for those quintiles, as Bill explained, and then it breaks out further of that fiscal of that total expenditure where the money would come from the tax levy, water, sewer, some CPA projects, bonding, and what's OB grant. Oh, it's like an operating budget and then revolving funds?
Recreation
revolving fund?
That's actually okay. For the copy of the $3,000.
Okay. And then where it says future fiscal year slash none, the ones that you'd put into the bottom bucket, so to speak, you've pushed those all out to next fiscal year. That's that last column on the second page.
No, some future.
Some future. Not necessarily. Okay.
And ones with the X's, Margot, for instance, the last two.
Yes.
If we do the phone system, they're not some future year. They're probably not at all.
Because we're just doing something different.
Correct. Right.
Okay. So in terms of your own, as you described it, this new hybrid process, presumably you would start next year with some of these projects in mind to slot into fiscal year 17 or maybe future fiscal years for your six-year plan.
Excuse me, we'll review those again. Some things we're just not ready for
sure.
Yet. In fact, starting this February, we're going to be meeting on a much more regular basis monthly to start that process of reviewing instead of the heavy up September through December and slightly in January and February. So it's a whole new game.
Are there other questions regarding
the number that's in here now for the phone system is a placeholder?
No, it's the number that is needed to replace the phone system. It's being
so that's not as, that has nothing to do with the presentation that we.
Oh yeah, it's the number that was in the presentation.
Remember by asking whether the phone the.
Yeah, I remember that.
Okay,
I
don't remember that's the 378. They called it 375 on their number, but it's the same thing. It's the IP, IB.
Town phone system, fiscal year 16.
Yeah, voice over IP.
Or call phone system.
The ones at the bottom that have the X's next to them, telephone system with voicemail renewal, telephone system with voicemail renewal, those are the ones that would be unnecessary if we went through ahead with the other expenditures. So that's a little bit redundant in terms of the capital list of capital projects in that case.
Yeah, I'm slightly confused about where that number is in this presentation also. I mean, the back page of this presentation says that the replacement cost for the, well, the borrowed cost for the new centralized phone system was $475,000. So I'm having a little trouble with where the 378 is.
I think I remember seeing it at 375.
But that looked like that looked like one of three options.
Yeah, so that would be, so that's,
this is the
yeah, I think that's the maximum estimate, the largest, the most conservative estimate of what would be needed for if we went with the vendor.
The page number, but doesn't exist.
Yeah, so townwide phone system solution costs, total hardware and install capital, vendor A is 375. Now, vendor B was less, but if you took that as a conservative estimate, in this capital projects plan, it was 378, just $3,000 off.
Yeah, and also I'll just state that this presentation was developed before the Finance Committee made their decision to consider paying for this out of tax levy funding as opposed to borrowing. Our earlier modeling was assuming borrowing for the replacement of the phone system.
So are you saying that we should just disregard this part entirely, essentially?
Yeah, because it's as it stands right now, some are saying we should not borrow for it.
That back page.
Back page, yes.
And just one other little minor thing. On the new chart that we handed out tonight, the two-pager that we've been referring to, it was attached to the memo in the package. With respect to the telephones, we were showing two columns, you know, the individual tax levy cost and then a cumulative column for tax levy. We forgot to carry over the 378 into the cumulative column. So the bottom line total for tax levy should say 2,839,664. It's actually shown anyway. Summing up everything above it, but just to be clear.
There's actually one other item that is not on this list that we're trying to find a home for. Somewhere along the lines, there's the committee collectively thought it was being presented for fiscal year 17. And this is a feasibility study for the schools. So there may be another, is it 78,000, $79,000 to go on here.
That actually, so you're saying that you were operating under the assumption that it was for next year, but it's for this year?
Yes.
Okay.
And that was just as of.
Okay.
That's feasibility study for space needs?
Space needs, okay. And so that was not, therefore, compared or put into a bucket? Okay. Are there any other questions for Mr. O'Connor about this information?
I guess just ask Mr. Reed, when do you anticipate we would, as selectmen, have to start trying to finalize our thoughts on this?
Well, the schedule has the selectmen finalizing approval of the town meeting warrant on February 17th. So we have two other meetings before then to work on this.
I assume we'll be talking about this next meeting?
Actually, three other meetings. Let me think. February 2nd, February 9th, and then the night of the 17th itself.
Mike?
What was the role of the software in the analysis?
Please pardon my deer in the headlights response. I don't even know what it is, Mike. I really don't. Because the committee, again, with this being a new process, really went through each and every one of these. And I don't think we even know what the way the computer was on it.
I would just say in response to that, that at a staff level, the software is very important in developing and putting forward a six-year plan. Because all of the things are programmed into the system, and so staff is seeing the things and looking at things that, you know, we should look at and make sure that we're not forgetting. And so in the overall six-year plan that we've proposed, it's based on a lot of information that comes from the system, the capital asset management system we're using.
I would add to what Rick just said, that while the committee did not actually ask the computer to give the committee its ranking, the documentation that we received on each individual project had lots of information that had been entered into the computer about whether it was a safety issue, how it'd be purchased, how it'd be used. So all of that, because it was in the computer, was in front of us, and that was helpful. It might be interesting when we start to go back to ask that question, just to see, we'll ask Ms. Jessica to see if she could dredge that up, just out of curiosity.
That's what I was referencing when I said, you know, how many 8-inch black pipe elbows we have. They put it
It's in there.
It's all in there. And I just can't say enough of how much the department heads really worked on this year. There were some eye openings for all of us across the board, and I want to, you know, if he's here, he's not here, so I don't have to make him blush. One of the challenges we've always had on town meeting floor from our active residents has been issues with respect to vehicle replacement. Roy really took this whole, let's spread it out, let's see what we have to heart. And in the past, we've had, you know, the initial volley of, okay, we need $800,000 worth of vehicle replacements this year. He's kept it down for a constant over a six-year period, looking it out at under 300. So, I mean, kudos to him and the other department heads for really looking at what they have. And so we won't have, you know, the spikes here and there that spread it up very, very nicely.
No, I would echo that, having seen the presentation that the selectmen received about the vehicles. I think that the need to provide adequate information and the mechanism for analyzing it and the committee's participation in this sort of dynamic process is really coming together. And I thank you and the members of your committee for your flexibility in what I know is a challenging hybrid situation at this point. I think this is really moving us in a very positive direction in terms of our ability to plan and to stabilize the volatility in our capital. And I think this is a great start. Is there anything else, Mark?
Yeah, just so, Rick, we have two copies of this, and then so one of them you adjusted. The one that came in the memo, with the memo, is where you have adjusted the total levy because the 378 wasn't in it.
No, it's the one that was handed out tonight. The one that was in the memo, I believe, had the... Yes. Yeah, that's the only difference between the two versions.
The old one.
The old, no, well, that's what you said, though. The old one is listed at $2,461,000, it really should be $2,839,000.
Yes.
Yes.
The one attached to the memo from Capital Expenditures.
Yes and no, yes, from the standpoint of...
But the bonding number is...
Bonding is reduced.
Yes, but the bonding number is too high in the Capital Expenditures memo. And so the 4,853,962 is the correct number, the total bonded amount.
What's on the new...
What's in the new memo.
What's in the new memo is correct.
Yes, yes.
So if I remember correctly what Mike asked about, so the capital, the model currently shows a capital article at 2.8?
It does.
And so does it also show, anticipates the bonding cost of 4.8?
Yes, it does.
Okay.
And in the Dropbox, we'll find a revised one that just sums up the cumulative total for that.
Just-in-time delivery.
Yeah, I was going to say.
Thank you.
I'm still trying to make sure I have the pieces of paper agreeing with each other. Then I'll get to the Dropbox.
So, just so that you know, from a bonding cost, there isn't much of a bonding cost for the first year on those projects.
Right.
Because at the time, there
will
be more efficient costs.
Great. Thank you very much, Mr. O'Connor.
My pleasure. Thank you.
Careful.
Okay, our next item. Town Hall Building Systems Replacement Design. You have to help me with this. GNAP Design Associates. Mr. Alani.
When we reviewed the project, we changed the HVAC system, among others, from the VRF, the variable refrigerant flow, to the VAV, the variable air volume. And as a result, we have to redo the design right now. So this request is to cover the design costs to redesign the systems.
So this just brings us in line with what the proposal was when we came to town meeting last fall with the change in the HVAC system that we were choosing to go forward with. And so now this is just the design, the ramifications of that to change the design to match what we
Correct.
Chose to do.
Yes. So this $48,500 is part of what was approved at town meeting. This is not in addition to, but this is part of the whole project.
Correct. Are there any questions concerning this?
And on the second part, just to make you aware of it, that when the project was designed, there were no controls to add to it. So I'm requesting that we put $8,500 aside, not to exceed $8,500 for the Meter Engineering LLC. One is they would help us design the controls for it so that we have a remote control over it. It's an EMS system, energy management system. Two is those two consultants would actually act as peer review for us as a third party to make sure that the design is the way we want it.
Okay.
So that's a future request. Correct.
You're just alerting us for the...
Yes.
That's good to know. Thank you. Are there any questions or concerns? If not, I'll take a motion.
Move Selectmen to approve change order number 2 to GNAP Design Associates in the amount of $48,500.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded. Is there any further discussion? All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed, say nay. Any abstain? 500. Thank you very much.
Drive safe.
Absolutely. Next on our agenda, we have annual town meeting review of proposed warrant articles. Mr. Reed.
Thank you.
Never going to get a quorum for this. Now the vehicles replacements are off the table.
So this is the compilation of our current plans for town meeting coming up. The actual list of articles is on the front page of what I just handed out. It hasn't really changed since the selectmen saw this last week. We're still planning 23 articles at town meeting based on what's been submitted so far by boards and committees. And the warrant, the first draft of the warrant is shown here. Certainly it has a lot more work to be done. We'll be doing that over the course of this week, assuming we're not preoccupied with other things. Probably at next week's meeting, all of the articles that are listed will also have text associated with them. In terms of actual proposals.
Thus it begins.
So, under consideration, but unlikely at this time, the underground utility lines for the Great Road. I understand what a Herculean effort that can be. Do we have a sense, would we wait till next annual town meeting on that?
We don't have to. We could address it either, well, let me say it this way. If we addressed it this annual town meeting or at a special town meeting in the fall, the timing of implementation would be the same.
Okay.
So no time is lost by waiting to the fall.
Great.
We did have a meeting a few weeks back with NSTAR and asked them to give us some preliminary cost information, and we're waiting to receive that. I really think we need more detailed information from NSTAR in order to be able to present this to the town meeting, and so until we get that, we won't be ready.
Okay. And I guess I'd ask this a similar question about our desire to start entering into a dialogue about potential legislation to increase the number of all alcohol licenses, that we're not in a position to move forward with that on short notice. Would we hold off till the fall?
If that's
we wanted to move in that direction.
Sure, if that's the selectman's desire. We are working on some research within our office regarding communities around us, what they've done, how many licenses they have.
Okay.
So we'll have probably information about that to present next week.
So we may be ready?
We could be, yes.
Okay.
I just comment on something. I think I've said this before, but I'll say it again now about the underground utility lines. I'm concerned that we are hinging all of the other potential improvements to the Great Road on the burying of the utility lines. And maybe we need to sit with the master plan again, but I don't think it's necessary to do it that way, and I'm concerned that we are not making any progress on any of the other potential physical improvements to the Great Road because we are hinging this thing on the potential to start a process that could take several years to get those utilities underground. I'm just putting it out there. Wouldn't bother me in the least if we don't go to annual town meeting on this. If we were at the same time making some progress on the potential for other physical improvements, there was lots to be done in the name of the master plan. And I'm just concerned that this is.
Mr. Sagenthaler, we discussed this at the staff level, and we agree that we don't need to approach it that way. So you'll be hearing soon from us about phasing and how we could implement portions of the Great Road project without.
Good.
Ahead with you too.
Well, I'm glad I brought it up then.
Very formal tonight.
Okay. Are there other questions concerning the preliminary article list? Nope.
Editing will be done next time.
Yeah, I think there's a lot of blank spaces to be filled in, so this is what will be curled up with our warrant in the snow. Yeah, well, this is the blank spots. Okay, moving right along in that case, we have proposed fiscal 2016 operating budget departmental budget reviews. Mr. Garofalo.
I'm going to interrupt you in 9 minutes.
I'm sorry, what's that?
I'll interrupt you in 9 minutes to open the public hearing.
Oh.
That clock is not quite an hour.
Thank you.
Yes, it's 7:36.
7:30.
So I will just start out by saying that also I have another handout to give, which gives a little bit of an update to what was in your package.
I have three copies of this.
No, one is mine. One is mine. That's mine.
Oh, well, there you go. That one's yours? Okay. Oh, good.
Oh, we got another.
I think I just got this.
This is different than the one that we have. No,
look at the date on the bottom.
Yeah. Oh. We have this
one. 126. It was on the desk.
Desk.
Okay.
The same.
Oh, okay.
126.
Yeah,
126.
Yes,
okay.
Right.
So the 126 replaces the 122 that was in our packet.
And the 126 replaces the 126.
There you go. Like a well-oiled machine tonight, folks.
9 minutes.
7:38. I don't want that to slip on.
We don't have to open it exactly at 7:40.
What is that?
Just no early open stuff.
Under the guidelines.
Be home and off the roads.
Yes. No pressure. Of course not.
Okay. So, Finance Director Garofalo did hand out to you budget books that contain a complete budget. You also had that in electronic form over the weekend, except that it was updated today, so there's a slight change, and I'll just mentioned the change was in the Public Works Department, having to do with some utility costs that we had further been able to look at and reduce by roughly $11,000, was it? And you have a 8.5 by 14 legal sheet that gives you a summary of all the budgets that does comport with the detailed handout that you just received. And right now, as submitted and currently as recommended by me, the selectmen's discretionary budgets are proposed at $15,531,858. So this is $20,951 over the current Finance Committee guideline for selectmen budgets. And there are also some contingency items that are still out there to potentially be funded. One of them is related to the Youth and Family Services Department. That's the third page of three that you have before you tonight. The other two relate to the Facilities Department, establishing a lead maintenance position per the compensation as specified in the contract, and then also a additional funds for painting in the Facilities Department budget. We can come back to facilities in a few minutes, because since the Youth and Family Services Director is here in the audience, we might want to hear from her in a minute or two about the contingency request. I will say that there are a few things that staff proposed along the way in assembling the budgets that I am recommending, and I guess not necessarily that where we're $20,951 over the guideline, that I would equate the reason for that to one thing, because there are a variety of things that we addressed to incorporate into the budget. But one of the proposals that we are making this year is to add a $20,000 appropriation for roof inspections. Mr. Alani has suggested that in his facilities. And so if he took that away, we would only be $951 over the Finance Committee guideline. And still, we would have addressed some other things that staff had identified that we'd like to add to the budget this year. So I outlined those in my report to the Finance Committee, the newer things that are being added to the budget that are a little bit over what we've done in the past. Wasn't a lot of ability to add anything to the budget, because the budget is based on essentially an instruction to staff in departments to add or to target approximately 1% in non-salary related expenses. And most people were successful in bringing their budgets in that range. The rest of the increases in the finance guideline relate to our personnel costs, which we can also talk a little bit. I will say that the all selectmen's budgets and the non-selectmen departments have received an estimate of the merit article appropriation for next year. The total proposed amount is slightly over $165,000, and the budgets as proposed here assume that level of funding so that it doesn't further affect the guideline in meeting the Finance Committee guideline. And we're going to talk about the salary administration plan at 7:45.
Wonderful. Ms. Baldup, would you like to come up and talk about this contingency, or just answer any questions that we might have? We do have your description here. Well, if do you have anything to add to what you've presented here? And if you don't mind coming up just so that people can hear on the microphone.
Okay. I don't know if I have anything to add other than what you said in the memo. This position has grown over the last, since like 2008, 2009 when it started. And in asking for this money, I don't ask for this, I'm hesitant in asking for it because I know how frugally you all are and how well managed the town is, and how, Rick and Victor really place a high quality on how we run the town. I feel like this position has demonstrated over its growth through the different grant funds that it can be of value to the town. I'm thinking ahead beyond the grant positions, because I think that some of what has been done with this has been grant related, and it's kind of taken our department and in a different direction than what it has. But I think in terms of where the community is going, I think that in the long run, that it's a position that could really benefit the town and the way the town is growing. And I think that we would have more control over what we wanted it to do, if it were funded in our department. The Safe Routes to School piece was how it started, and that's kind of fallen by the wayside to some extent because of the Healthy Bedford planning and implementation that has been focused at the community request on transportation and pedestrian access and mobility. And not that that's a bad thing. It's a good thing, and it's needed, for the health of the community. But, it's something that I think, it's bringing different groups in the town together related to some of these things. And I think that in the long run beyond this, and I'm not sure how far ahead I can see, but again, I think that it could do so much more. We've just gotten funds for mental health first aid training, which is something that a lot of communities are doing, and that fits more in with the mission of our department, and certainly is a focus of health department as well. That's a function that this position could do in conjunction with both of our departments, and benefit the schools, police, fire, and everyone else. And so, again, I think that broadly defined, I think it's a position that could really grow with the town. and benefit the town as a whole over the years. So I feel like it's been valuable, and I certainly, you know, will respect your decision around this. If it's not funded, it means that she would go down to probably 8 hours a week and likely would get another job, and we probably would not have the position, you know. It's one of those things that, you know, I suppose that I don't mean just to make that sound like I'm holding you hostage. But in terms of the reality of it, you know, it's, you know, we are always looking for other grant funds, and we did get requests from MAPC for more community transformation monies, but those monies are only going to be available from February through June, and when we really need the money is next fiscal year, because we have the money for this fiscal year. So, you know, you have a commitment from us to continue to look for funds to offset this cost if you would fund it, because we believe in that and we would do that. But right now, we haven't found anything. So I don't know if you have other questions with that. I guess I can just kind of, you know, say that.
Thank you. Are there any other questions for Ms. Bauda?
Well, so could we just clarify, Rick, whether or not I'm just trying to look at the budget numbers. The budget number you're carrying in here at 43,583 for Youth and Family Services, does that include this contingency request?
No.
So
the position exists and it's shown in the budget, but it's at a reduced number of hours that are currently provided for in the operating budget. So this is a request to increase the hours budgeted in the operating budget for that position.
So it's an increase of 17,424 over what's in the budget,
right,
which would make them just a little under 10 over rather than 8 under their FinCom guidelines. Right? So
right. Yes.
Madam Chair, we have a public hearing scheduled for 7:45. Point of order, should I move to open the public hearing?
We could open the public hearing after 7:45, or do we need to go?
It's okay to be a little bit late. Yeah.
It's already.
Yeah.
I have 7.
Unless there's someone in the audience that might object.
I have no objection to concluding this discussion before opening the public hearing.
So that'll. So we talk about the other contingency requests as well?
Sure.
So you know, in the budget book, we're just showing the grant fund, and if, depending on what happens, this line item either A is going to be removed as not being eligible, or it's going to be added to the top of the salary request for fiscal 16.
You're speaking of the Youth and Family Services?
Yes, on page 119 of the budget book.
And for those of you who may not know, this was an old youth worker position that we had money in the budget for that was added to some other monies that were contingency requests last year and added to grant money, so that it's like the position, there were some monies there from an older position that was transferred to this particular position. And it's been renamed Healthy Bedford Coordinator.
Okay, thank you for that clarification, Victor. Anything else before we move on to the other contingency item?
These are prioritized in from.
Those are the departmental, the individual department's priorities. Not, I just happened to staple them together, so they're not in particular order. Except that facilities department did prioritize theirs. So you're seeing two of their three contingency requests.
I have a question on priority two. I was under the impression that we already have this position in the facilities department.
We're asking for additional hours.
No.
I mean the lead maintenance.
We have negotiated for this. We have not assigned or budgeted for the stipend. So we don't have this position presently designated within the department.
At one time, did we have it? I think my son-in-law had that position.
It may have been, yes, that somebody had it before, but it's been vacant for some.
I'm trying to figure out what happened to it.
Yeah.
But currently, this position exists in theory, just not in practice. We have it in the structure. We just don't have someone inhabiting
it's,
that.
Again, it's the compensation is provided for in the collective bargaining agreement, but management hasn't designated anyone to receive it yet.
So the second one, Victor, you're saying this one is just increasing the number of hours?
Yeah, it's the facility director's observations since he's been here last March that there is more interior painting that needs to be done than we have funds to do. So presently, the appropriation is $18,540.80. And he would like to propose to increase that to $30,128.80.
How does that number relate to the number that capital expenditure sees regularly for spending?
Well, first of all, this is for town-related buildings, so it's not non-school.
Schools.
Correct. And there are no appropriation requests in the capital budget for town-related painting, interior painting. We try to accomplish it through the operating budget.
Are there any other questions?
I just also think we should point out that within the budget, there's a $35,000 line item for the capital IT from the finance department. Right now, we are showing here in the budget, but it's also on the capital list. And depending on how we proceed with the computer IT, whether that's going to be budgeted in capital or in the operating budget, it would be removed from there. That being said, by removing it doesn't really change the bottom line number being a deficit. If you were to look at the guideline is actually showing as if it would be funded in the capital account, where under the inception of two that means that 500 would show it.
So it could even exacerbate the difference.
No, it won't change the difference.
Won't change the difference.
It won't change the difference at all.
So now it's being now it's considered part of the capital article.
It's being proposed in the capital, but depending on the final decision of the selectmen whether that would be budgeted through the capital article, or you continue to have that shown on the town budget and the school's budget, depending on if it's removed. But from a bottom line, it doesn't change.
Yeah, if you refer to the 8.5 by 14 legal sheet that you had in your package and the updated one we just passed out, towards the bottom of the list of all the departments, there's a words that says adjust to meet guideline parens capital IT, and then you'll see to the right of that $35,000, which is included in the finance committee's guideline of $15,510,907. So we carry that number all the way across. So in other words, if we decide to take that out of the operating budgets and put it into capital budgets, the FinCom guideline will be reduced by $35,000 also.
How does this meet the definition of capital?
Without getting into detail, it was actually a suggestion from
the school,
from the school department to propose to have IT being budgeted in the capital article, and that was above the infrastructure that would also include computers and printers and monitors and various.
When I was on the school committee, we fought that battle every year. I thought we lost. Maybe the passage of time.
So if you look at the capital, you'll see that that's broken up into three segments. And the third segment is where under the school department, their computers are being proposed. They don't have any funding, it's 100%.
Well, that's the thing, is collectively, capital IT needs across the town is how you make the argument that it's a capital investment. Instead of making everybody request their own little 35,000 or 15,000 or whatever it is, collectively.
Mm-hmm.
Anything else at this time?
No.
Thank you, Mr. Garofalo.
Thanks for giving me some good reading for tomorrow.
Right.
Move that Selectman open the public hearing on the salary administration bylaw proposed amendment.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded to open the public hearing. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? Abstain, 500. Ms. Porter.
Good evening. You have in your packages a memo from me as well as a marked up version of the proposed salary bylaw. Essentially, anything that has been highlighted in the plan are the things that are proposed for change. So I'll walk you through each item on the memo, and then certainly if you have questions after that, I will be happy to answer them. So overall, for categories A, B, and C, and J, we are proposing an overall increase of 2.25% over the fiscal 15 rates. This is recommended based on what some of the town collective bargaining agreements have settled out in terms of the average base wage. And the only exception to this 2.25 increase is the category for temporary painter, which we are not increasing at all. When I talked to facilities director Alani, he felt that the rates paid for that position were well within the scope of the going rate for temporary painters. There is no increase to that one. In category A, we've changed the title of facilities operations manager under the M15 classification, and we are now calling that position the assistant facilities director, which is still going to be within the M15 classification range, and that title better reflects the responsibilities of that position. Under the, prevention services coordinator has been reclassified from an M12 position to an M13 based on an analysis of that position, including the responsibilities and required knowledge. That was something that Youth and Family Services Director Baldoff worked on. And the position of engineering and mechanical assistant has been added to the M11 classification. This was a reclassification that was done after an analysis of the responsibilities that were assigned to a staff member who was currently serving as an administrative assistant one down at the Public Works Department. So there's actually no change to the number of positions within the DPW. It's simply just reclassifying this one person with a different title based on their responsibilities. And we've also proposed removing assistant to the town accountant from the M10 classification and replacing it with the title of finance assistant. This was done to better reflect the duties that that position performs. It does a lot more for the finance department other than just assisting the town accountant. They also do help with some of the treasury side functions as well. And again, there's no change in the number of staff positions within the finance department, just a title change. Category D shows the current rates for the public works contract as of July 1st of this year. Category E reflects the current school nursing contracts as of January 1st of this year. And note that there is a new step 12 that has been added to the nurses' schedule in accordance with the collective bargaining agreement that was negotiated. Category F has the firefighter contract rates as of July 1st. And category G for the police supervisors and the patrol officers, those are the new rates there. Supervisors went into effect this January 1st. The patrol will be this July 1st. And also there's a new step 7 for patrol officers, again, consistent with the negotiations that came out of the bargaining process. And then under category I, which is recreation items, we've just made some minor adjustments to the pay rates under school-age child care program for one of the group leader positions. The youth center staff, we made a change to the adult staff rate, and then under instructional programs, we just changed some of the rates for instructors, and that was at the request of the recreation director.
Jessica, has there been discussion about school nurses ending up in the school budget, and if so, how does any of this feed into that?
Sure. I do know that there was discussion about them being moved over to the school side. I am not privy to where that stands now, but perhaps the town manager is up to speed on what is happening with that particular contract and budget.
Well, negotiations for the successor contract have not started yet, and what happens in the salary administration plan bylaw is that we carry the current wages until a new contract is agreed to. So that's one aspect of this. The other is that, aside from collective bargaining, the school system and the Board of Health have been engaged in those discussions, and you know, that may change. Where the nurses are located may change. Right now they're in the Board of Health budget. It could potentially go to the school department budget, but it is still under discussion between both of those boards.
When does that contract end, or when did it end?
June 30th.
Of this year?
This coming fiscal year. Well, the current fiscal year, this June. So there will be sometime this spring a new negotiation process for the nurses, regardless of whether it's under the Board of Health or the schools.
Okay.